let's start with the with part one of the Sola Busca series. Part one is called A Deeper Kind of a Slumber, and I will take you back to Atlantis time, and you can have a discussion about how long ago it was and when it ended. But for the most of us, I think agree like 10,000 BC. How long Atlantis period was is a matter of debate. Some believe Atlantis, the culture of Atlantis, stretching over like 20,000-30,000 years. Some believe it's much younger or much not that long of a period. I'm going to for the 10,000 BC date for the end of Atlantis. And why is Atlantis important in this series? This is about Sola Busca, right? The tarot deck from 1470 or something. Renaissance, at least, we can agree upon. It was the family d'Este who ordered the deck. Somewhere in the middle of the 1400s. One thing that is very important to understand is that, and what I want to argue about is that the Venetian families went over to Constantinople to study in the beginning of the 1400, like 1420. And the Sola Busca and the tarot tradition, I think, comes from Constantinople. And I think the knowledge the Venetian families took from Constantinople over to themselves, to Venice and Italy, was the start of the Renaissance. And I will also argue that the knowledge they found in Constantinople came from Atlantis from beginning. Of course, a lot of the original understanding might have been distorted, but I would say that the esoteric traditions comes from Atlantis time, distorted, and some of them more or less distorted, I would say. And I will argue in this series that the knowledge came from Atlantis and over to Egypt and Sumeria, all the way to Constantinople, and I will talk about how it ended up there. Of course, I will argue for my case here and try to show you as much evidence as I can. So in the Sola Busca deck, I think there are very old esoteric traditions encoded in the deck. And as Peter Mark Adams have pointed out, yes, a lot of this tradition comes from Hellenistic Greece, Persia. But where did that knowledge come from? And so this goes, for me, it goes all the way to Atlantis, and have taken different forms, and people have tried to understand the original esoteric method and traditions, and it have taken different forms. So what happened during Atlantis period, and why did it end? I think the Atlantis, what we can call the Atlantis culture, was empire with different countries. A culture wasn't bound to one country. It was a widespread culture. It seems to be a war going on in the end of that period, and some believe it ended with a catastrophic nature event. I go for a catastrophic technology an esoteric knowledge method event. And we don't remember much from this period. And that is for a reason. You can argue that we have had many floods, and we have many flood stories. And it seems to be a theme that comes about more than one time in human history. Now I'm talking about the flood that destroyed Atlantis. You can't think of a flood as in water. Certainly it was water as well, as in physical water that drowned cities close to coastal line and so on. But it was much more than that. And the easiest way to understand it is to understand the Hebrew letter Mem. The Hebrew letter Mem is about water, but also memory, destruction of language and nations, science. And we humans are made up of water. 70 to 80%. There is some debate about the exact amount, but between 70-80. And our DNA is important in water. And as Belial have stated, was that our DNA was damaged. We have 22 strains of dormant DNA, or young DNA as the scientists is calling it. So the destruction of water was also destruction of our memory, of who we were, of our own old ways, our old esoteric traditions, our old culture. And if you want to control people, you want to take away their memory and their understanding of who they were. And this is what Jehovah, the Enlil God, the Demiurge, wanted. He drowned humanity in water because we were sinful, together with the giants. Did he really want to kill humanity? Or did he want to kill the old understanding of who we were and our spark, our soul, our DNA, and shut down our memory and our memory of the past, and therefore drown the old humanity? What I have come to understand is more closer to the truth, that if you destroy the DNA, destroy the spark, then we lose our right to call us human. He wanted to destroy the humans. He wanted to make us into android, very easy to control, new species without soul, without spark. At the same time, shutting down our memory makes us very controllable, very easy to control. The Watchers have said that they let Nama on board of Noah's Ark when the flood came. And Nama carried the spark to plant the spark within the human race. And in doing so, the Watchers wanted to give us a chance to ignite the 22 strands of DNA that went dormant during this period of time because of the Demiurge. It's a reconnection to our old DNA and our old memories. Without it, we would be much easier to control. Now, they try to take away the spark within you. That's the reason why they have this transhumanist agenda. It's the same story. but with different method. But it is about memory. It is about language. It is about DNA. What did they know in Atlantis time, and what method and esoteric traditions did they have? Well, I can see that our esoteric traditions is probably a reflection of what they knew in Atlantis time. I don't think any of our tradition is new, rather a rediscovery of old traditions. The chakra and the kundalini work is very old, and it is the idea that you can connect to your higher self, the idea that you ain't your body, but you are soul, and that through this connection and through this method, you can have this a better connection to your spirit at the same time you are in your body. Some people feel that we should try to leave and go back to source. Well, if you connect to your higher self, to your daimon or your holy guardian angel, through chakra kundalini work, taking back and ignite your dormant DNA and so on, you will discover that our position in matter is quite unique. And if you end it, you will not be able to have the same experience again. And because shut down our possibility, or he made it harder for us to connect to this daimon, to our higher self, and to rediscover our soul. The soul is in your body, but your real authentic you is you find it through your spark, through your soul. And because it shut it down and made it harder, we have wasted a lot of time as a species. And I think we have been the demiurge have taken away our purpose here, and we should take it back before we choose to go away, because we haven't discovered or experienced all there is to experience from a position of a body, from the position of matter, to experience the metaphysical at the same time you are in matter in a body is a different experience than to say that I want to experience only metaphysical or my spirit higher self. During Atlantis time, I think the human race have had a very easy time to soul travel, for example, to leave their body, to leave the material aspect of themselves and go to higher realms and different realms that are purely metaphysical. And if you have that ability, you will have a completely different view on matter. If you can leave whenever you want, then you have a completely different ontology or worldview about the view, how you view yourself and reality, the world around you. For example, you soul travel, say you are in Atlantis time, and you are, and I think most humanity have these abilities, then you can have masters, but I think it came more natural to us to soul travel. So let's say you choose to soul travel and you go to Amenti, and you are there for a couple of hours, and then you come back into matter, you will also see the beauty of matter. You will not feel trapped, and you will discover that this is a very beautiful place. It's the same time when you travel today and go to a different country, you are there for a month, and it's wonderful to have new experience and experience new places. But when you come back, it feels quite nice to be home again and see the familiar structure and meeting friends and so on. I view this as a similar thing. If you are used to soul travel and you go away to different realms, different planets, and so on, and you're used to do it, and you do it for a long period of time, and remember, time is an illusion, so you can go there for a very long time. Can feel like days, a month, different realms. And then you come back to matter and you see a sunset or sit by a fire with a loved one, and you will understand the beauty of it because it has been absent from you for a while. The people from Atlantis time, they soul travel a lot, I think. They visit different realms. They have teachers who taught them in a very young age. We can have a discussion of how many of humanity during this time did it, but more than today. And it came more natural to them. And of course, soul travel is only one method. Of course, they could. With soul travel comes the ability to remote view, for example. They can remote view. They have their DNA intact. They could probably manifest matter from the metaphysical, that is to manifest material stuff from the metaphysical into matter. They have probably crystals they could put in memory, healing abilities. And of course, the language they used during this time reflected this, because language express what you can do and what you can talk about and have an opinion about, both in metaphysical. In the metaphysical and in matter. So if you see the hieroglyphs, for example, here the hieroglyphs is a metaphysical language. They try to create a language that could express their experience in the metaphysical for a person who was in matter. During Atlantis time, I think the language reflected the metaphysical, but it started to shift in the end of the Atlantis period. I think technology started to take over the human mind, and technology needs another a language that goes between the metaphysical and matter, a language that could express very complicated technical stuff in matter and in the metaphysical at the same time. I think the esoteric people during Atlantis time was split up into different strands or groups. One was inclined to technology and saw the potentiality in technology in combination with esoteric knowledge and method. The other group saw this as a problem, technology in and of itself, but if you go too long or take it too far, you start to create chimeras, genetical manipulated animals. You start to distort nature. You want to colonize the solar system and so on. At the same time, you start to lack wisdom because technology start to take over. Then I think this group, who said, no, you have gone too far with your technology. And the genetical manipulation and your need to go to Mars with a vehicle or a spaceship is flawed. If you can soul travel, for example, you can go to Mars without a vehicle. You can learn how to go to Mars. You don't need NASA. You can learn a method how to go there. The only thing you need, hopefully, if you have it intact, is your body. And the body is your temple. Your body is your alchemical temple. And this split created a war or a struggle. And we can see this playing out today. You can see this in Egypt. For example, what is the pyramids? Some believe the pyramids are like 10 to 11. It's from 10,000 BC. They say it's the end of the Atlantis period. And you have these pyramids. And the pyramids are a technology. A technology in combination with esoteric method. Now you can do a lot of different things with the pyramids. And some view them as a positive thing and some negative thing. You can use technology for many different reasons and in many different ways. But the danger with technology is that it always end up in the more negative, in a negative light, that a group with esoteric knowledge and method start to use this technology for their own. And I think that is exactly what has happened. I also think the end of Atlantis period, it ended with a catastrophic outcome because of this technology, because of weapons of mass destruction and so on. But I don't think the group, the esoteric group that view technology as a good thing and took it too far, disappeared. I think they ended up on different planets in our solar system and underneath us in tunnels. And I also think they saved their technology and took it underground and took it to different planets to hide it. The catastrophe I'm talking about is an apocalyptic event. It's an event of mass destruction. And of course, this is also about MEM. Remember, MEM is language, memory, all kinds of things. And all of these catastrophic apocalyptic events in combination with endless the demiurge wish to drown humanity, create a humanity that is really fragmented. But the group with technology can have ways to store knowledge, store memory, if they can keep their technology. And if they can keep it hidden from us, they will come out of this event with the memory and the knowledge and the technology intact. The problem is that they have to start all over again, because they are few, they are not many. Rather, we are the many. And if you want to control the many, you don't want to give them knowledge. And you want to keep them in the dark. And since the demiurge have seen to that we was in the dark, this elite took the opportunity to take over. But they needed us to create their infrastructure again, because they have a technology-based esoteric method. Now they had to go very slowly and with method about this. If they teach us too much, we can see through their agenda. If they don't teach us at all, we cannot start to recreate their infrastructure in place for them. Knowledge and what they shared with us was about to recreate their civilization, we can call Atlantis, and in their vision of it, the technology-based, esoteric-based Atlantis. And that is what we have done. And today we can see that it starts to play out again. Now we have put the infrastructure in place, now they don't need us anymore. Now they want to drown us again in water. They want to make us forget who we are, take away our spark, take away our soul. They talk about technology. They talk about language, because science is a language. How we speak in universities and so on, it's a language. It's a language within a language. So if you use English in a university, you also have a certain version of English in university. How you put the structure together when you write down your essays and so on. So we are here again. And this esoteric traditions and method, this elite have kept for themselves. But during this period of time, is a very long time, and it's very hard to keep it secret always. Therefore, their knowledge has started to leak out slowly and surely, and we start to understand what they know. And we have certain periods in history where this knowledge have leaked out more than others. Sometime it has leaked out in a distorted form and in a more real, authentic form. But it is hard to keep things hidden all the time, especially after the Middle Ages. Things start to happen, and this esoteric elite, the technology-based elite, needed to push their agenda forward, because the infrastructure we put in place has to mimic what they had during the end of Atlantis time. Therefore, they also have to give us more knowledge how to put this infrastructure in place. It means that we have to start to build buildings in a different ways. It means that we need to invent electricity again. It means that we have to put internet in place again. For example, when they gave us internet, they knew that they pushed a button and some people will pick up on it. And some people will connect and will be a problem for us. They ain't stupid, but they had to put this infrastructure in place for the future plan. So it's a struggle of time. Time is of essence. Either we rediscover what they know, and of course use it in a better way, or they will take over. A lot of this knowledge ended up in Constantinople. And I will go into more details how and what it means. And from Constantinople, it ended up in Venice, because the elite families of Venice went over to Constantinople to study there. And I think when they saw that the Muslims started to invade Constantinople and try to take over, it became more important to get hold of the esoteric knowledge and to transport it over to Venice. I think the knowledge and the esoteric method with the tarot comes from Constantinople, and that the family, the Este from Venice, used their knowledge and understanding from Constantinople to put the Sola Busca deck together. So in the deck you will find a lot of esoteric tradition that goes a long way back, and I will trace it from Atlantis to Constantinople and to the Este family. And then of course I will decode the deck and talk about it, and also take it to the future and what it means. We can all agree that the tarot deck is something that it's a very powerful method. Some people believe it's only about divination, but we know it's a lot about it. Is that's the least thing it is about. If you are into Thelema and OTO and so on, you claim that the most secret esoteric knowledge come from Egypt, and that Egypt is the most important reservoir of esoteric knowledge. And I think there is a lot to that. And we all know that from Egypt you have Sumer, and Sumer is also mirroring Egypt in many ways. And I think to trace this back, we should go to Egypt and Sumer next. We also know that Plato, and in the Hellenistic period, points back to Egypt, and that he gets the knowledge of Atlantis from Egypt, and Solon and so on. And that's also a connection to Egypt and Atlantis. So I think it's a lot to it. And you can also see the hieroglyphs as an in-between language. So you have the hieroglyphs, you have cuneiform language, that is a metaphysical language and not a language that describes material reality, but a language that is aimed at the metaphysical endeavor and method in esoteric traditions. And we can also see this in Enochian language. And some believe that the Enochian language come from Atlantis time. And the Enochian language is about how to communicate with a certain spirit family of spirits. When we have gone further down into matter, our language has also reflect that downfall into matter. Our language reflects the material world. And of course, the scientist is like, why do they use these stupid symbols and so on? They're stupid and they don't understand anything. No, the language is a metaphysical language. It's not stupid. They had a different view on reality themselves. They had a different ontology than this atheistic, materialistic prison we have created. Doesn't mean that they are stupid, but rather that they understand that matter is not all. It is not everything. In the next episode I will go back to Egypt and Sumeria and that part of the world and discuss that. And of course it will be easier when we go forward into history because it's more recent. But we can all agree that between 10,000 BC and 5,000 BC, it seems to be a huge gap of memory loss. We don't know what's going on there at all. It's like a vacuum. And I think it's because of the demiurge Enlil who drowned humanity, the old humanity, our old culture and ways and tradition and esoteric method. But not everything was drowned in water. But sad to say, I think the group with technology came out of this in a much better shape than the rest of humanity because of their technology. Because they could manipulate nature with technology. Because they could survive with this technology underground without a sun. Therefore, they came out with memory intact, but not the human race as a whole. That's how you control. That is how you manipulate. You use technology the rest of humanity doesn't understand exist because you have kept them in the dark. Okay, thank you for listening and have a wonderful weekend.